This is Thank You Mama, weekly lessons for mothers all around the world. Dear listeners, this is a very special episode for me because in a way it celebrates a very special milestone. A few weeks ago, my husband Nick went for his 5-year cancer checkup and he was marked clear, which is incredible because it means Nick is now officially cancer-free and there are no more checkups. To celebrate, he started a fundraiser for the American Cancer Society, and I published a story about what I've learned from my family's many, too many battles with cancer. I will post a link to Nick's fundraiser and to my story in episode notes for you to check them out. And I just wanted to say thank you for being here. Hi and welcome to Thank You Mama. My name is Anna Teider and I have a very, very special and dear guest today. My guest is Munira Premji. She's the author of Choosing Hope and the host of Choosing Hope podcast. Munira is originally from Moshi, Tanzania. She moved to Canada in 1979 to do her university studies, get married and have 2 children there. And she is a human resources expert, an executive coach, and she's consulting on organizational effectiveness and leadership development. So Munira, you, for me, I know you are originally an HR expert, but I know you as a fighter for hope. I know you as a warrior for hope and for all that's positive and good and awesome in life. How did that happen?
First of all, Anna, I'm just so delighted to be part of your podcast. I admire you. I love your podcasts.
Thank you.
And I can't believe I'm a part of it today. And I love the way you described it, a fighter for hope. I am a cancer warrior and I have battled 3 advanced cancers over a 5-year period, non-Hodgkin lymphoma, breast cancer, and multiple myeloma, which unfortunately, Anna, is an incurable cancer. Like you said, I've written a book about my journey with cancer. And what I love about this book is it talks about my journey with cancer, not just from my perspective, but my kids and my husband have written in this book as well. So they share their perspective of supporting someone who's gone through cancer. I'm a wife and married to my best friend for 38 years. I have 2 kids, Shane and Sabrina, who live in Nairobi, Kenya. And I like them both very much. I am a podcast host like you, Anna. I am a work in progress and I am perfectly imperfect.
But Munira, one of the most awesome things is when I just ask you, how are you doing? The first thing you told me is, my health is good. Congratulations to that.
I really am. You know, it has been an incredible roller coaster for me. And I have really gone through so many twists and turns. The breast cancer seems to be behaving, even though it has metastasized. With God's grace, I seem to be okay. The non-Hodgkin lymphoma was a very aggressive cancer, but that seems to be behaving as well. The multiple myeloma is a pesky cancer. It's incurable at the moment, and I've had 2 stem cell transplants. My last stem cell transplant was 14 months ago, and my oncologist is beyond happy with how well I'm doing. So my numbers look great. Some days, Anna, I forget I have cancer. Mm. You know, I'm just living my life fully. I'm living my life fearlessly, and I'm living my life on my own terms. So I feel that there is somebody up there in the universe that's looking after me.
That's beautiful. And I'm very excited to talk about that a bit later, connected to your mom, about somebody being out there. But Munira, here's one interesting thing I'd just like to talk to you quickly about. we decided to do our episode now because my husband Nick is celebrating his 5-year clear and started a fundraiser for the American Cancer Society to celebrate that. And to support him in this, I sat down and wrote a story about my being on the side of all the cancer battles in my family. So among other cancer warriors in my family, there's my father. So I called him just to make sure that I didn't put anything wrong in my story about this. And then we talked about his battle with his cancer. And he said, and it really stayed with me, he said, "Do you remember the homeopathic doctor went to see?" He said, "One of the most important things that I've learned from this whole thing," he said, "that when cancer happens, the whole family is a patient." And it's interesting that you mentioned it about your book.
Yes, you know, I have so much to say about that, Anna. The caregivers are the true heroes. Because as a cancer patient, you need to go through what you need to go through. You have no choice.
That's what Nick said. It's interesting. Yeah, it's interesting you say this. Nick said, "I think this was easier on me than it was on you."
Yes.
"Because I am fighting my battle and I just close my eyes and go through it. And you are standing by and you're like, oh, what do I do?"
And he articulated that so well, Anna, because the truth is that oftentimes the caregivers are really helpless. They want to help you, but they don't know how to. They don't know what you're going through. So sometimes they go overboard and they overprotect, which gets you as a cancer patient really annoyed. And so there is this real dance that happens. And it is unfortunate that they are the forgotten ones, because people always ask, you know, "How's your wife doing?" But really, it's about the caregiver and all the things that they're going through. I mean, it's very much like going through your own battles. And I think it's so important for caregivers to have support of other caregivers who understand what it's like, because I'll tell you, your dad said it so perfectly as well, that it becomes a journey of the family, and the family goes through their own ups and downs. And you know, I have to tell you, Anna, some days, even today, I have a little bit of guilt that I put my family through this, because they didn't ask for it, and it's nothing that they signed up for. And then I know that this is not my fault. And as a family, we went through it together. We got closer as a result. We all grew from the experience. But man, the caregivers are the true heroes of this story.
I had a very tough time supporting my mom because as much as we always talked about everything, and there was no topic that was a taboo for two of us, when she went through her battle, it wasn't a topic. She didn't want to talk about it. And that left me not knowing how to support her. Because if you're not, can't even talk about what the situation is and how serious it is and what's really going on, then you don't really know how to support. But let me ask you, do you have one lesson that you've really learned through your battle?
Yeah, there are a number of lessons. One is really around accepting what you cannot change, because acceptance and radically accepting that I had the cancer allowed for space to change, because I couldn't will the cancers away. You know, I couldn't wish them away. I was in the midst of it. I couldn't project into the future because I was living and am living on borrowed time, which in many ways is what we're all living in. We're all living in borrowed time. And so one of my biggest lessons, and it came early on, was to radically accept what my lot was and not fight that. And once I did that, and I totally submitted to that, and submitting in it, not in a passive way, but submitting and saying, "I don't know why this has happened, but there is somebody that understands. God has the master plan." And rather than fight that, let me embrace it. And it's only when I embraced what I had that I was able to go through it in a really a positive way, if that makes sense. So that was probably one of my biggest lessons.
It's interesting you're talking, and I'm thinking how to implement this or understand this for people who are not fighting cancer. And I've actually been thinking about acceptance of what is recently, because I'm seeing so many burned out and unhappy people around me.
Yes.
Even though I'm surrounded with a group of people that shouldn't have any complaints. And what occurred to me is that I think in this country, which we don't have in Europe, there's this feeling that you can always be better and you can always have more and you can always achieve more. And there's never an end. There's always more. And once you have children, you have to buy a house. And once you have a house, you have to save money for the college. And once you save money, there's always more. And I was talking to a friend in Europe and she said, that's the difference. We're kind of more accepting on what is and making that good and enjoying that. Of course, both has pluses and minuses.
Yes.
But I'm connecting that to what you just said as a bigger lesson, even without a cancer battle, to sometimes try
yes.
and accept what is and just make the best of what is and enjoy what is yes. and not waste time striving too much.
You know what? And if I could just add something to what you said, you know, before I had the cancer, I have to tell you, I was like the individuals you're talking about. And to me, it was external. You know, it was about the title and it was about how much money I was making and it was about the house. And, you know, unfortunately, fortunately, I think that's a society we live in here.
Yes.
And that's what I would strive for.
Mm-hmm.
But I will tell you, one of the gifts of cancer is I stopped looking at the external
mm-hmm.
and I started to look at more the internal.
Mm-hmm.
And what I realized is when I started to focus on, you know, peace of mind and quality of life and, you know, things that did not have external connotation, that I found my magic.
Yes.
You know, and
yes.
so I totally resonate yes. with where you're coming from.
That's beautiful. Munira, should we jump into the mama topic?
We can do whatever you want, Anna.
Let's talk about mama. I am very, very lucky because out of, I think, 60 interviews I've conducted by now, this was the first time that I met mama as well, that mama came to the interview and waved behind your screen and we had a little chat and that made it feel very, very special. Thank you for that. So tell me about Mama Zeta Kanu.
My mom lives in my heart. She is 91 years old, and she is this tiny 88-pound quiet ball of energy. She was born in Zanzibar, and she's one of seven sisters. And it was really fabulous because about 5 or 6 years ago, she had a chance to go back to Zanzibar to visit it. And she was like a kid in a candy store. She had a camera and she was showing everybody where she was born and the street that she used to play in and the stores that she remembered. It was just beautiful to be a witness to that. So my mom and her family
mm-hmm.
then moved to Mombasa, Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
When she was a child.
Mm-hmm.
So she grew up in Mombasa, Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
And Mombasa is this beautiful place with warm tropical waters. It's a lazy, laid-back place.
Mm-hmm.
It's infused with African, Arab, and Indian influences. It's got market stalls and spices and tiny streets. And that's where my mom grew up.
Munira, I'm sorry to interrupt you. I'm very sorry. But since you're talking about Kenya and we talked about it earlier, let's say hello to the listeners in Kenya. Because as I told you, I'm so surprised that the third biggest number of my listeners come from Kenya. So hello, Kenya. Thank you for listening.
Yes, and Anna, my two kids live in Nairobi, Kenya.
I know.
So I'm sure they will be promoting your podcast as well.
Okay, sorry. Let's come back to Mama.
So my mom was very unusual for her generation. She loved school and she loved books. And she was one of two or three girls who graduated high school, mm-hmm. Which was, again, very unusual for her times. And then my dad came calling. It was an arranged marriage, mm-hmm. and he lived in Moshi, Tanzania. And Moshi is the town of Mount Kilimanjaro. And next thing you know, my mom was whisked to Moshi, Tanzania, mm-hmm. and had to now learn to be a wife, mm-hmm. and went from a family that was very quiet to a really rambunctious family, very loud, entrepreneurs, mm-hmm. A very different life for her. And she tells me that it was difficult for her to adapt and she had to find her space.
Munira, what's about languages? Because the language of Tanzania is Swahili. If you move from Tanzania to Kenya, what language do you speak to your husband and his family?
Right, great question. Mm-hmm. So my mom could speak Swahili, my dad could speak Swahili. Mm-hmm. But the language of our community was Kachi and Gujarati, which is the Indian dialect.
Oh, now we have to talk about that.
And they also were able to communicate in English.
Okay.
So we grew up in our home learning English. Mm-hmm. So yeah, my mom became a mom, mm-hmm. and I have an older sister, mm-hmm. Naz. So Naz was born, and then 7 years later, mm-hmm. I came into the picture, and my mom then settled in Moshi. Mm-hmm. And in Moshi, I was really quite fascinated because I was a little kid and my mom started to participate in a lot of different committees within our community. So she was part of the women's committee and the religious education committee. And she was one of the two women in that year who became a member of our Ismaili Council, which is like a really big deal. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I really appreciated that as a kid growing up. Mm-hmm. But my mom was really a trailblazer of her time. And it's only now that I go, wow, that's like amazing.
Munira, will you tell me, I'm sure the listener is a little confused. Now, I asked you about your second name. I said, it sounds Indian and you are from Tanzania. And now you mentioned the Indian roots. Tell me a little bit more about that.
Yes. So my grandparents, maybe two or three generations before, came from India and they moved to Africa and they made Africa their home. Mm-hmm. And so I had the wonderful occasion of actually visiting India about 10 years ago for a conference I was presenting at. But other than that, you know, we haven't, as our family, we haven't had much interaction with India, but it is definitely where our great-great-grandparents mm-hmm. came from. They took boats mm-hmm. and found their way into mm-hmm. the interior of Africa. So mm-hmm.
are there many Indians that did that?
Yes, there are many Indians. And what's interesting is many have stayed there. Mm-hmm. And then many in the last generation have actually moved to Canada and North America.
Well, do you know why, Munira? Why did Indians back then want to move to Africa?
Yeah, I think it was opportunities. A lot of Indians were entrepreneurs.
Okay.
And they moved to Africa for opportunities.
Oh, okay. Wow, we are learning. That's what I love about this podcast. It's just opening the world to me.
And to me.
Thank you. Okay, so Mama Zera, so she had only two of you.
Yes.
And she was a trailblazer, we learned, because she was so active in different organizations and women's groups.
Yes.
When did she move to Canada to you?
So then, unfortunately, what happened is my dad passed away mm-hmm. Fairly young. He was only 52.
Oh.
and we owned businesses in Moshi. And so my mom stayed in Moshi for mm-hmm. a couple of years mm-hmm. to wind down the businesses. Mm-hmm. And then my husband and I sponsored her. Mm-hmm. And she moved to Canada.
Mm-hmm. How did she take the move?
You know, my mom is rather incredible in terms of the acceptance that I talked about earlier. Mm-hmm. She radically accepted that this is going to be her life. She was really happy to be here with my sister and with me. Mm-hmm. You know, she'd never been to Canada, so I can only imagine how difficult mm-hmm. That would have been for her, leaving everything that she knew yes. to come to a new place. Yes. But she embraced it.
How old was she at that stage when she moved to Canada?
So my mom would have been about 55,
okay. mm-hmm.
give or take, when yeah. she moved yeah. to Canada. And shortly after that, we invited her to come and stay with us. Mm-hmm. And so my mom and my sister stayed with us, and we've been living together for 34 years now.
Oh, wow.
And it is a really happy home, and I feel right. so grateful every day, you know, to have her in my life, to wake up and see her every morning.
Oh, I can imagine. I can imagine. Let's learn from her. Let's talk about what are the most important things you feel you've learned from her.
I think I am who I am today because of her, and if I could be half what she is, man, I would be thrilled. She is my role model. She is my best friend. And, one of the things that really amazed me about her is she's 91. She looks 60. And she has the wonder of a child, you know. And we call her at home Curious George, you know, from the books, Curious
yes,
George,
yes.
the books for children. Because, you know, she sits on her iPad probably for 2 hours a day. Mm-hmm. And, once a week we cook something different. And I'll say to her, where did you get this recipe from? And she'll say, oh, from Google, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. And, every once in a while when something will happen, she'll say, oh, I learned a new way to clean the carpet. You know, I think we need to try this. How did you find that? Oh, Google.
So she's still very active. She's 91. She's cooking and cleaning carpets.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah,
wow.
She will, you know, she'll see that there's a drop on the carpet and she'll say, I found a way to do this. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's not unusual for me to see her sweep the floors and she doesn't have to do any of this stuff. But, you know, every time I look, you know, she'll be like in the garden raking the leaves.
Wow.
Or, I mean, she's amazing. She's like this Energizer bunny. And sometimes I can't keep up with her. I literally cannot keep up with her, you know. And I think that's what I love about her. She will exercise every morning.
Oh, she does.
And she doesn't do anything dramatic, but, you know, she will do her stretches. And she will often say to me, you know, I've noticed that you haven't exercised in a while, Muni.
No.
And, you know, you must exercise to keep your body strong.
Good for mama.
You know? She's doing that. Yeah. And so she keeps active and, she's a reader. Mm-hmm. And she reads in a funny way. She doesn't ever read her book from, you know, beginning to end. She'll take it from the middle. Mm-hmm. And then next thing I know, she's reading the end and then she'll go back. It's a really good book, and then she'll read page 3. So I don't actually know if she reads the whole book, but she does that. And she loves to listen to religious, you know, stuff. And she will listen to Wayne Dyer, and she will listen to all these things. And then every day she teaches me one lesson, which is great.
Oh,
every
wow.
day. Yeah, we have a date together when we are cooking.
Oh, wow.
And I will say to her, so what do you have to teach me today? And it'll be a story or a lesson or something that she picked up from what she listened to the night before.
That's amazing. That's beautiful. I think I want to start this with Kai. I'm going to take this tradition from your mom and teach my son a lesson every day, consciously teach him a lesson every day.
Yeah. I mean, it was happening. And then I said to her, let's do this every day. Let's make this intentional. And so we look forward to doing
beautiful.
That every morning. Yeah. So there's something about looking at the world from a place of a beginner's mind, mm-hmm. looking at the world from a place of awe and wonder. But, you know, she extends that. So the other day I saw her walk outside and she was at a neighbor's garden and she went into the garden and I'm thinking, Mommy, I don't know if you should be doing this, but I was watching from my own home from the window and she went and she was, you know, checking out their Christmas decorations and stuff like that. And I thought only my mom would do this and she would do it so non-self-consciously, you know, yep. because she's curious.
I love
that. Or she will watch something that's happening in our neighborhood and she'll say to me, so did you see that, you know, they've got new lights, mm-hmm. you know, in this home. And there's something about that that I love so much. You know, she doesn't take anything for granted.
Yes.
She wakes up every morning and there is something to look forward to. There is this beauty and it's her curiosity and it's just so refreshing, Anna. Mm-hmm. It is so mm-hmm. refreshing.
But it sounds like not only curiosity but also perceiving things, like opening up
yes.
to see things, because you could be curious but have a blind on you and just, you know,
yes.
see what you want to see. But this is something that I've also learned from my mom, I believe, to really open your eyes. It's, I don't know how else to explain it, but to allow things to reach you, you know, to see them
yes,
and hear them and notice them, to observe.
Yeah, there's a sense of open-mindedness,
yes,
right?
Yeah,
and not
yeah,
judging. And,
yeah.
and I think that's so true about her. And sometimes she forgets how old she is.
Mm-hmm.
Like if people come to our home, mm-hmm. And we have people that come to our home all the time, pre-COVID, obviously, and she's sitting on a chair, mm-hmm. she'll get up and ask a 30-year-old to sit on the chair. And I'll say to her, You have earned the right to sit on a chair. You don't have to get up for a 30-year-old.
Yeah.
But that's what I mean. She just forgets how old
mm-hmm.
she is.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to be like her when I grow up.
Me too. Let's move to what you mentioned to me as the first lesson about the grace
yes.
and the faith and acceptance of what is.
You know, my mom, when I was very young, she would always say to me that I needed to be like a lily in the water. And I'd say, why? And she'd say, because a lily lives in the water, and yet the minute a drop of water touches it, it shoos the water away. And so she says, the way to live in the world is to be in the world, but not off the world.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that that's how she lives her life because, you know, she's very engaged in the world. She's very engaged in what her grandkids are doing. She's very engaged in what she's going to be cooking today. You know, she's very engaged in what's happening in the world around her. She's, you know, very engaged in the news of the world. And yet, there is something about faith, you know, she's very clear that she's in this world for a short period of time and that she needs to prepare herself for life hereafter. So her faith defines who she is. So she is very much a spiritual being in a physical body. And because of that, she approaches life in the way that when things happen to her, she accepts it with all of her, with her heart and her mind and her soul. And she embraces it and moves on with it. And so her life is one of harmony all the time. You know,
mm-hmm.
there is no anger. There is no bitterness. There is no anxiety. I mean, I've never seen my mom like that. It's
oh,
it's all that.
Wow.
And that's another lesson, really, and it's around love. You know, Wayne Dyer says that when you open up an orange, what do you get? You get orange juice, right? You get orange. And so it's kind of like my mom. If you were to open her up, all you would find is love. You know, she... That's how she lives. And I've noticed, for instance, that even when she cooks from a place of love. When she's having a conversation with me, it comes from a place of love. Like my mom is all love. It's remarkable. I've actually never met anybody like that. And I wish that this is something that I could be more like her. But everything she does, everything she thinks, everything she acts, everything she believes comes from a place of love. And I think that that's how she operates. And I don't even know how to explain it because mm-hmm. I don't know that I understand it, mm-hmm. Anna. Mm-hmm. I don't think I understand it. Mm-hmm. All I can say is that I see it. Mm-hmm. And so there is that grace about her that is pretty darn remarkable.
Mm. Munira, now I understand why you and I found each other. Because I think our moms are very, very similar. How right. beautiful is that they are from completely different generations, different backgrounds, different yes. parts of the world, and they are so similar. Do you think, now I'm thinking of my mom, because describing how she lives life with love reminds me of my mom. I've been thinking about this a lot, and I've learned for myself that that was her love for life. As you said, yes. I think maybe because she lost her parents so young, my mom always appreciated, as you said about your mom, that life doesn't go on forever.
Yes.
This is maybe why she embraced it so much, with so much love. Like you said, she approached everything from this place of love, which I think was really just the joy for life, joy for being alive.
Yes, and I think while they were... and there's so much similarity between them. I think the difference from speaking with you about your mm-hmm. mom at great length, Anna, is your mom was incredibly vibrant.
Yes.
And she was a performer yes. and she was an yes. artist. My mom is none of that.
Mm-hmm. She's shy.
My mom mm-hmm. is quiet.
Yeah.
And shy.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that that's the beauty about what we're describing mm-hmm. right now, that they both had a very sure sense of the purpose of life. Yes. Your mom did, mm-hmm. my mom did, and how they chose to live it was very, very different. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think that's the beauty, and that's the love about people. You know, we each have our story, yes. and we each have our purpose, and we each have our way of being, and they can show up so differently, and yet we can live such beautiful lives. You know, what I feel sad about, Anna, are those individuals that take life for granted yes. and just wait for it to end. Mm-hmm. Then I feel very, very mm-hmm. sad for those people because mm-hmm. I think to be born human, mm-hmm. to be born in this time, mm-hmm. you know, is such a gift. It's mm-hmm. a gift from God. We just need to embrace it. Mm-hmm.
To be born at all, not only human.
Yes.
I'm always
yes.
I'm spending so much time in nature now, and it's January and things start budding already. The moment it gets a little warm, yes. things start budding, and I get so inspired and think how life wants to live. You know how nature wants to live. It wants to be born. It wants to exist. That's the magic.
I love that metaphor. I love that metaphor.
It's and as you said, many people are just think they're so busy, just hide in work and everyday things and just dig their head in the sand, and then they realize what happened when it's too late.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, Anna, you mentioned at the offset that I'm going to be a grandma.
Yeah.
Twice over. My son's wife and my daughter are expecting. And, you know, I've been thinking a lot the last few months since we got the news. I've been thinking a lot about what kind of grandma I want to be. And your invitation to be part of your podcast came at such a great time because I was thinking about what my mom's given to me and what I want to now give to my future generation mm-hmm. who I can't wait to meet in June. And it's really just such a beautiful time of being there for them fully mm-hmm. and unconditionally, like my mom was for me. When I was diagnosed with 3 cancers over 5 years, it was a really difficult time. And I didn't know how to share that news with my mom, because how do you tell your mom that
yeah.
you are, I mean, going to die, because I expected to live, right? And her reaction to me was so beautiful. She just hugged me and she said, "Don't worry, everything will be fine." And the minute she said that, I believed it, right?
Yes.
And her unconditional love of me at that time is what allowed me to go through the darkest periods. And I keep thinking to myself that that's what I want to do. I want to do that now when I have the opportunity to be that person, to show unconditional love, mm-hmm. and to have my kids and my grandkids know that when they come to me, that there's a safe space, that they don't have to prove themselves, that mm-hmm. I know that they are worthy for who mm-hmm. they are. Mm-hmm. And it's just the timing of all of this is beautiful because it's a time of reflection.
Ah, beautiful. I'm excited about your grandchildren. Monira, let's jump into the question of, is there anything you wish she taught you? Anything important she was not able to teach you?
You know, I have been wrecking my brain about that. And I, you know, she never taught me how to cook. Mm-hmm. Or to stitch or iron. And I probably would not have been a good learner anyway, because I was not interested in that at the time. And I brought that up with her yesterday. And I said, you know, I'm trying to think about what you didn't teach me. And it was interesting. The first thing she said was, I didn't teach you to cook. And then she says, but at that time, when you left home, I didn't know how to cook either. So I suppose what we're doing is we're making up for lost time now, because how many individuals are lucky like me, Anna, to have my mom live with me mm-hmm. for 34 years, mm-hmm. you know? And so we are making up for all the times that I left home, and I left home really early. And so we are now learning from each other and teaching each other. But it's interesting. I don't know how to sew. I can't hem anything for the life of me. But I don't know that I'm interested in those things.
I just wanted to ask you, is there something you think it would be easier if she did teach me? Or do you think it doesn't matter? Would your life be easier if you did know a few of those householdy things?
Well, I didn't know anything about getting married and falling in love. We never had those conversations. Yes. And, you know, I think it's important to have those conversations. Yeah. But again, you know, those were different times. But no, she taught me to be open-minded. She taught me all the important things that I needed to learn. Mm-hmm. And she continues to teach me.
That's beautiful. Monira, is there anything else you'd like to share before we recap?
No, I feel complete, Anna. I forgot we were recording a podcast. This felt like a conversation, to be honest.
It did, yes. I will put links to your books and podcast in the episode notes so that my listeners can look it up if they're interested. Help me to recap. I have Grace, Radical Acceptance of Life, which came through faith.
Yes.
I wrote down she's a spiritual being in a physical body.
Yes.
Then I have love. I have that she's filled with love, and everything that she does is filled with love. And we talked how that comes from this acknowledging that life is not forever, that we only have, how lucky we are that we are here, and how our life here is not forever, and this is why we should rather fill it with love. Then I have curiosity. She seems to be learning the whole time, and that's something you have learned from her. I wrote down wonder of a child and beginner's mind, and I love it that every day she consciously teaches you a lesson now. Every day she learns something new, and she shares it with you at the age of 91, please.
And, yes.
And apropos the age of 91, I also wrote down, because I think it's very important, and my mom did this, and many ladies that I interviewed that are still in a great shape do this, exercise every day, just a little bit. It doesn't have to be anything special. You don't have to do a Zumba class every day, but a little bit of stretching and consciousness of your body and appreciating your body every single day. And I think that's what I have for the lessons. And then we talked about what she did not teach you. And here we have cooking and housework, which in a way wasn't that important at all. And you also mentioned getting married and falling in love. But because she gave you the healthy base she gave you, we said, it's okay. You don't really feel like there's anything you wish, anything she missed.
And I think the only thing I would say to conclude is, you know, she is 91. Mm-hmm. And I know that life is not forever. Mm-hmm. And so one thing that I do very, very mindfully is I live in the moments with my mom. Mm-hmm. Because I can't worry about the future. I can't imagine her not being with me mm-hmm. forever mm-hmm. because she really lives in my heart. Mm-hmm. And so I'm making the most of every moment count. And I did that, Anna, even when I was interviewing you about your mom. Mm-hmm. And it's about we need to live these moments because they are precious. Mm-hmm. Life is fragile. Mm-hmm. And I've learned that living in the moments is all we have control over.
Munira, thank you so much. This was a real treat for me. I hope for my listeners as well. Thank you for bringing so much love and sunshine and hope and joy and lessons.
I love chatting with you.
Yeah, I do too. Thank you for saying yes and being my guest.
Thank you, Anna.
If you enjoy Thank You Mama and want to help it grow, please take the 2 seconds to leave a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts. It really helps. If you'd like to get in touch, you can send me a mail at info@thankyoumama.net. You can also find me on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter under Anna Tider, that's TAJDER. This was Thank You Mama. Come back next week, subscribe, and tell your friends.